Well, to help us to understand a lot more about both what we have now in terms of artificial intelligence, but what is yet to be discovered, I'm absolutely thrilled to be introducing one of our own alumni, Rohit Talwar, who is the CEO of Fast Future Research and is absolutely fascinated by the future. His book, The Future of Business, brings together 60 leading futurists to really think about what the future is going to be. And he's going to run a panel with three of those futurists, two of those futurists, to really help us answer the question, what if we could see into the future? Thank you very much.
Well, good afternoon. And thank you all for coming back after lunch. It's been a fascinating morning so far. We're now going to try and take you on a little bit of a journey. As was mentioned, myself and two of my colleagues, Gert Leonard and Gray Scott, are going to be talking to you, both futurists. And what we're actually going to be talking to you about is a book that's launched today. We decided back at the end of January that we wanted to bring exponential thinking to publishing. We wanted to create a book of insights that would help people think about what's changing in the world and what would that mean for business. And we wanted to do it in exponential timescales. When we talked to publishers, they said to do a book with 20 contributors from around the world will take you 2 years. So we said, well, how do we do that in 6 months or less? And we actually set a target of publishing it in June. The books did actually arrive earlier, but that kind of classic technology succeeds, people don't. When the courier got to the building, somehow the courier and the building didn't talk to each other. So the books are now heading back up the M25 somewhere. So hopefully they'll be around somewhere. Anyway, and what we're really going to do is to share some of the ideas coming out of this book. I'm going to start off by giving you a broad picture of the landscape. Gray is then going to talk to you about what happens when automation and digitization really move to the next stage and the boundaries blur between the real and the virtual. And then Gert's going to explore the boundaries between human and machine and how do we start making choices about that. So where do we start? I think where we start is really an understanding that we're seeing two worlds collide. On the one hand, we have those who are born physical. They make houses, they're lawyers. They do things in a very physical way. They see the world as a very analog thing. We make relatively incremental improvements. That world is now clashing with a planet of people who are born digital, who think digital. The interesting thing about those people is they don't see houses, cars, legal contracts. All they see is data. And they see that every problem can be solved by finding the right algorithm, applying the right technology, or finding the right science to address it. And more importantly, they're also growing up with Moore's Law, which tells us that computer power doubles roughly every 18 to 24 months. And they're saying, well, how do we apply that exponential thinking to business? So you're seeing that clash between the analog, the digital, the exponential, and the linear growth models. And so organizations who are born physical are saying, well, how do we evolve? How do we cope with that world? How do we evolve our DNA to survive in that world? One view is we carry on playing by the rules we understand, the assumptions we've grown up with, the rules that the rest of the industry play by. Others are coming in and saying, no, actually, in order to succeed in your sector, I'm going to change the game itself. So if you look at what happened with Skype, they came along and basically took the telephone industry's core product and made it available for free. They now handle 40% of all international telecoms traffic with less than 1,600 staff, and they don't charge a penny for it. They make their money on additional services. So we're seeing that happen in industry after industry, either players coming in from outside saying, let's change the game, or the players inside the sector saying, we're going to have to change the game in order to evolve. What we also know is that the people who seem to do the best job at preparing for the future actually look at three horizons. Firstly, they're very clear on what they're trying to bring into land in the next 12 months. Secondly, they're looking out 1 to 3 years to say, what's going to drive growth and innovation? And what are the forces of change in the outside world that could help or hinder those strategies? And finally, the very best have an early warning system where they're looking out 4 to 10 years to say, what's coming over the horizon and how do we prepare for that? And hopefully what you're going to hear today...
This is your house.
Okay, that's a distended voice from somewhere in the darkness. What we already know is, you know, we're at a fascinating point where we don't know what to believe about the future. So Nick Bostrom, the Oxford philosopher, tells us that we might already be living in the matrix. We might be living inside the simulation created by a higher intelligence in another planet on another galaxy, and we wouldn't know. What we can be certain of, though, is that we're a very digitized species already, and we're living in a world that's connecting 3 billion people, even before AI kicks in, via the internet, which has become the backbone for society for many of us, backbone for business, the backbone for the way we live our lives. What we're seeing as we look to the future, and what becomes very clear in the book, is that businesses are facing a number of design tensions. I'm just going to pick a few of them. As we try and map out future strategies, some tough choices. One is, you know, we're seeing reports that suggest anywhere between 47% and 80% of all the jobs that exist today and the notions of work will disappear in the next 15 years. Some people are saying the new industries will replace them. Others are saying they won't. We might need a universal basic income. And firms are having to make that choice now about how much importance do we place on people and nurturing talent versus automation. Secondly, we're seeing that in this world where everything's becoming automated, we're reducing it to algorithms and numbers, there's a risk that we lose the feminine. And we're seeing more and more people now starting to ask the question of how do we recapture those feminine traits of people and organizations, whether it's intuition, imagination, connection, empathy, balance, that do seem to drive performance. And the final one is this kind of battle that's raging right now, where in many sectors, whether it's internet search, social media, whichever sector you look in, you see this battle playing out between those who are going for the kind of winner takes almost all mentality to dominate a sector, very much a Star Wars mindset, versus this growing view that actually we could be living in a Star Trek world where there's abundance. If you look at vertical farming and green LED farming, bringing food prices down to next to nothing, 3D printing, again, doing the same with physical goods, the internet becoming a free distribution mechanism, we're seeing this sense that actually we could have a world that looks a bit more like the Federation in Star Trek, where everything was free and there was no money. And we're seeing more and more organizations saying, which side of the fence do we want to play on? That is all a backdrop then to the kind of speed of development of exponential technology. And this was mentioned this morning. We've identified a number of technologies through the book that really are going to drive tomorrow's industries, from 4D printing, which will give us objects that can change their properties, to artificial intelligence, which you'll hear more about, to human augmentation and enhancement, whether it's life extension or genetic treatments that will actually allow us to change the color of our eyes, the color of our skin, and the thickness of our hair. There's a technique called CRISPR-Cas9 that's been already piloted that actually does that, or could do that for us. We're seeing a range of these technologies, though, driving the industries of tomorrow. And what we see is that there's a massive evolution going on in terms of the scale of technology and its performance. So we started life with mainframes, we moved to the desktop, we evolved to portable, luggable, mobile, then to the smartphone. The smartphone has transformed our world in the last 7 or 8 years. So what happens in the next 7 or 8? Well, one of the things we know is we're moving into the era of wearable technologies. But if these were being patented 3 to 5 years ago, then what comes next? And what we know comes next are the embedded technologies. There are already millions of people who have pacemakers, cochlear implants for hearing, ocular implants for their sight, already walking the planet. Right now, devices are coming to market or being patented that will heighten our senses, do drug delivery, monitor our various bodily conditions, all embedded within the body. Even memory for your mobile phone. So you'll get that call on a Friday afternoon saying, Miss Jones, please come in Monday morning, make sure your ears are clean because we're going to give you an upgrade. And we know all of this is being connected. On the one hand, connected to the Internet of Everything. 15 to 20 years from now, we could see 50 billion to 250 billion objects connected to the web, from phones and computers or whatever replaces them to our cars and our fridges. Those in turn will be connected to something like a trillion sensors. All of that throwing off a wall of data, which organizations will either drown in or find innovative ways to leverage their advantage. Perhaps even more interesting, though, is that we're tapping into the senses. Last year, you could buy into something called the O-phone. The O-phone allows you to transmit up to 356 different scents to someone else with an O-phone. Add to that the work that's going on touch and taste stimulation, and within 3 to 5 years, we know hotel groups who are working on the idea of allowing you to smell the bath products, taste the food in the restaurant, and feel the bed linens all via your device before making your choice. Where we're moving is a world that will completely transform. We do pretty much retail in any sector. And then we're moving into this world that's increasingly artificially intelligent. If you do computers, if you do internet search today, if you use a smartphone, if you fly a plane, if you buy a financial services product, you're already using forms of weak artificial intelligence. It's getting smarter all the time. Lots of Hollywood movies about the idea of getting to artificial general intelligence where it could be as smart as humans. A long way to go before we get there, but we know it's getting more functional. On Friday, I was with IBM Watson, and they were demonstrating to a group of corporate law, general counsel lawyers, a development of the technology where they could do a search for companies to acquire, evaluate them, and do the due diligence on them in 30 seconds using Watson, using an ordinary English conversation. The lawyers in the room said, at best, it would take them 3 months. The rate of advance in AI is phenomenal. We're going to see a lot of applications, and Gert in particular is going to talk about that. What we know is, though, that what AI is going to give us is intelligent assistants that sit inside our technology that help us navigate the world and manage our interface to the world. In 2 to 3 years' time, it's very likely that when you're dealing with your customers in the consumer world, you won't be dealing with them, you'll be dealing with their intelligent agent. We'll also have our digital twin who'll sit online, who would be doing search and doing all sorts of work on our behalf online. The issue comes when the digital twin starts to argue with you about who knows best. And we know that all of these advances in science and technology are enabling a number of sectors. Again, in the book, we identify 30 sectors that we think between them will be the bulk of the global economy in about 15 years' time. Firstly, there's a cluster of information technology in the sectors. I'm not going to go through the list here, you can read for yourselves. But really the ones that are creating the backbone of society, from everything that happens on our mobile devices through to artificial intelligence being embedded in literally every aspect of society. Secondly, there's a whole bunch of technologies that will transform the way we do construction, from rapid construction to using biomimetic principles to design tomorrow's buildings. We also know that there are a number of sectors that are ripe for transformation. The classic one, for example, being infrastructure. $30 to $100 trillion of infrastructure is required around the world today. We know we have to speed up the processes and cut the cost of delivery. Transformation of that industry could be phenomenal. A fourth sector is everything that's going to power our planet and clean up the environment and protect the environment. And again, these are trillion-dollar industries in their own right. The next are a set of citizen-focused services and the things that will provide our domestic infrastructure. For me, the most interesting ones are the ones around the human, things that will augment our bodies. One of our authors has written about the idea of body shops on the high street, where in the same way as you go today to have a haircut or a tattoo, in 10 years' time or so, we could be going in to have genetic treatments to modify our skin color, replacement 3D limbs printed for us, replacement prosthetics, and even age extension treatments. Peter Diamandis is one of the kind of pioneers of the abundance movement, believes that life extension could be a $6 trillion industry. And then there are the things that provide the fabric of society, the things that will give us new food, the circular economy. You know, what we see today is that when now if you buy a car in a BMW car sharing scheme, there are 16 of you owning that car. We're completely changing our view about assets in society and how they get used. Why do I need a drill? Why do I need to own everything that I only use once or twice a year? And all of that is then forcing businesses to say, well, how do we prepare for tomorrow? How do we prepare for this world? And what we see is two sets of responses. One is the attempt to create magic. The other is to, you know, creating mayhem. And they're both, if you like, facets of the dragon. The first is a lot of experimentation going on around business models. We're seeing people move away from owning assets to renting them, whether it's cars, computing systems, or even buildings. We're also seeing lots of innovation in terms of how we finance innovation, with crowdfunding platforms becoming more popular, even for corporates to pre-test their product before they develop them. But the most interesting area of innovation that we're seeing right now is around the pricing of goods and services, where people are becoming really innovative in how they charge. My favorite one is the auction model because it's a license to print money. The example you see on your screen is from madbid.com. How it works is that when you make a bid, the price up goes up by one penny, but you pay a £1.50 bidding fee to make your bid. So if in the first example, we have a TV that's £630. With 25 seconds to go in the auction, the winning bidder's pretty happy because they're paying £20.59. As the vendor, you're even happier because you've had 2,059 bids at £1.50 each, which means you've made £3,000. In the second example, we're selling a £614 laptop with 26 seconds to go. This is where we start popping the champagne corks because we've made nearly £9,000. But the one that makes you get up in the morning, the one that makes you want to send letters to your headmaster or headmistress and say, look, I did actually make it, is the last one where you're selling money. Here, we're selling £125. 4 seconds into the auction, we've already made £81. Typically, that £125 will sell for between £10 and £50, which means you will make between £1,500 and £7,500 for a £125 outlay. I'm not necessarily saying that all of you should sell all your services and products through auction. What I am saying is we need to start experimenting before the market forces us to with new ways of charging for goods and services. We're also seeing a focus on speed. With business cycles shortening, technology changing industries quicker, we're seeing people say we have to get faster in the way we deliver. This is a construction group in China that built this 30-story hotel in 15 days. They basically prefabricate it in the factory and then assemble it on site. They're building 30 or more of these around the world because their view is, and their clients' view is, we can't wait 2 to 3 years to build a property because the market will have moved on. We need to respond in that window. This is an example of exponential thinking in practice. And what we know is exponential thinking, that idea of bringing Moore's Law to business, is happening in sector after sector. Look at Airbnb, handled 90 times more customers per employee, 90 times more bedroom listings per employee than the average hotel group. Look at the bottom of your screen, Tangerine, 7 times more customers per employee than the average bank. But the mind-blowing one is the one in the middle, where local motors can deliver a new car design about 1,000 times cheaper than your typical car company and can produce each model off the line 5 to 22 times faster. Why? Well, the typical Ford has about 5,000 components. The typical 3D-printed Strati has about 50. That kind of thinking can happen in any sector. What if you gave yourselves permission in your organizations to say, what could we do exponentially? Where could we abandon the myths, the assumptions, the worldviews that constrain us to the way we work? And what we know is that that thinking drives exponential financial growth. You look at Uber. Uber's basically a taxi company with no assets. Their valuation has gone up 20-fold in 3 years. We're now seeing others adopt these models. So Amazon are now saying, actually, we're going to take the Airbnb model and have you use your spare bedroom and your spare time to do our deliveries for us. We're going to see a number of industries being reinvented by people starting to say, how do we recycle capacity in society to give us exponential growth? We've also seen the rise of technologies like Bitcoin at the digital currency. More interesting than Bitcoin, though, is the underlying technology called blockchain, which is a super secure protocol for communicating information. The NHS is looking at using it for all data in the health service. People are using it for banking. Because what blockchain allows you to create is a totally distributed ledger of all your transactions that's transparent. It's a trustless system. You don't need central clearinghouses. So people are saying, actually, what we could have are smart contracts that self-execute on the blockchain. They'll know all the clauses of the contract. If they get met, we'll execute them. That, in turn, is then setting up the idea that actually we could end up with entirely software-based companies, companies where from their strategy right the way through to execution, everything is written in software. If you look at Amazon today, it already handles 15 million legal disputes a year, entirely automated. And more people are now starting to say, we can use things like blockchain technology to write companies that only exist in software. So we'd start to think of companies themselves as technologies, and we'd start to create clusters of companies that are groups of technologies plugged together to do whatever we want to do. That also gives us the idea of the non-owned enterprise. So the people now in the car industry saying, actually, we could have self-driving cars that own themselves. All the people who contribute to the manufacture of that car would simply take a stream of rent from the car. The car would rent itself out to whoever wanted it over the entire day. It would manage its accounts on the blockchain. It would be totally transparent, but no one would own it. Could we take that to entire organizations? The thinking is becoming possible. What we do know is if we look at the pace of advance of artificial intelligence, of robotics, of holograms, it's very likely that in the next 5 to 10 years, our HR department is going to have to think about how we manage a workforce that has humans, enhanced humans, robots, holograms, and some sort of AI manifestation all in that workforce. How do you manage that group of people? How do you deal with that? All of this means that we're going to need a whole set of different work skills to help us navigate this world. And if you look at the leadership agenda in most organizations and the training agenda, we're beginning to see people say, actually, we need to embrace things like complexity thinking, scenario planning, complexity skills. And what we know is that it doesn't end there. Because if you look at all the research that's going on, the next wave of advances beyond what I've just talked about are the point where we start to be able to read the content of our brains and write to the content of our brains. And a number of projects are working on this, with the potential of actually uploading our brains to the internet as a backup. The really interesting thing, though, is that the internet and silicon communicates information about 1,000 times faster, about 1,000,000 times faster than we can do inside our heads, which means you could actually put that brain to work for you to work in parallel to your physical one. Again, there's that issue of how we reconcile the two of them when they start to disagree. All of this lends us to what people talk about as the singularity, the point where we start to network our brains and create the internet of brains. So my time's up. I hope it gives you some feel of just kind of where the world is moving, some of the forces that are shaping that world. But what we do see is that these changes are driving some tough choices for business about what are we going to be in the future, how do we want to behave in the marketplace, what is our final financial orientation between control and abundance, what is our approach to talent in the world we're moving into, and then how do we organize ourselves behind that, the technology, the processes, the structures to make that possible. So I hope that's made some sense and given you a little bit of food for thought. We haven't got time for questions now, but we are going to take a Q&A after this session in another room where we'll all be there so you can ask us questions or challenge us or throw things at us. But what I want to do now is to just hand over to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Gray Scott, one of the youngest futurists on the circuit, the founder of Serious Wonder magazine, one of the most influential online magazines out there. And Gray's going to talk to us about something called the singularity reality. And Gray, please come join us on the stage.
So I wanted to talk to you today about what if the future was simulated? And I know this sounds like a far-out idea. I'm sure most of you don't use this kind of thinking in your everyday lives. But the great thing about this conference today is this allows us to think into the far future. The steps that we take today will lead us into the far future. So imagine a future where every sensorial experience that you have is digitized, quantified, and predicted. How will that change our lives? How will it change our behavior towards our family, our friends, our customers, and how we do business with the world? How we represent ourselves, how we represent who we are as a digital being in a digital substrate. So this slide, I'm sure you all talk about the digital black hole all the time. This idea of the digital black hole, where everything in the future gets digitized, quantified, and miniaturized, sounds unbelievable. It sounds far-fetched. It sounds like science fiction. But I'm asking you to think, where is all of this headed? Every time we digitize our vacation photos, every time we digitize any experience that we have, where is that leading? I believe that we're headed towards a digital black hole. I've been calling this the simulated reality singularity, meaning that all information that gets digitized gets collected and eventually gets crunched into a singularity. The futurist and a friend of mine, John M. Smart, calls this the transcension hypothesis. It's a fascinating idea. Basically, what he's saying in this theory is that to solve the Fermi paradox, meaning that why aren't we seeing intelligent life outside of our planet? I'm sure you all thought you would come today and talk about extraterrestrials, but that's what we're going to talk about in this slide. So when we talk about the transcension hypothesis, what John is describing here is a computationally optimal domain of increased, dense, productive, miniaturized, and efficient scales of space, time, energy, and matter. It's a mouthful, but that's where we're headed. Every time you create a new file, every time you create a new document, that is being stored somewhere. Even if we don't see it in front of us, it doesn't go away. Now, there's been a lot of talk about digital hoarding, and I'm sure most of us, when we go on vacation and we take 100 photographs, maybe we use 5 to 10, maybe 20 of those photographs. Do we delete those photographs? Most of us don't. Most of us have a huge collection of information online that we never see and we never use. And in the business world, we have a lot of this too. So how do we get to this black hole state where everything is crunched and miniaturized? The first thing that we're going to see is the automation of everything. The second stage is digitization of everything, which is going to lead to the simulated reality singularity. So we've been hearing a lot about artificial intelligence. We've been hearing a lot about automation. Some people say it's coming. Some people are denying it. But the one thing that we know for sure is that automation plus digitization will lead us in one direction. We have to miniaturize our data. We have to crunch our data. I believe we're headed towards a crunch in digitization, which is why I'm describing it as the automated or the singularity of simulation. So the first stage of this is self-replicating robots. So imagine that you want to create a laptop for yourself in the near future. You have to get the raw materials for this laptop. You have your 3D printer, and you need to get those raw materials to your 3D printer. If we could create self-replicating machines, robots, that were autonomous, that could pull those raw materials out of the ground, ship them by a drone that's autonomous, and deliver them to your 3D printer, that supply chain looks very different than what we have today. So the digitization of everything that's going to come with the automation of everything sort of in a way acts as a fetus in fetu. It cannot be separated. These two things go hand in hand. And when we look at the world today, and when we look out into the world of media and file sharing and EEG headsets recording our thought, our brain waves, all of that information is getting stored in the digital space. One of the areas that I'm really concerned with is the amount of information that we're pulling into the cloud. Those are real servers. Those actually really exist somewhere. And they're very hot. I don't know if you've ever been to one of these centers, but that kind of heat is a problem because we have so much information being stored in these centers. So what do we do with that information? Can we gather all of this information into a virtual reality utopia? Can you experience a simulated reality in the future that is as real as the reality we see around us now? And I think you can. We will use time dilation, the ability to speed up and slow down the simulated future. Now, if you're wondering how we get into the simulated future, one of the ways is virtual reality headsets. We're going to be looking in the near future, probably in the next 6 months to a year, where a huge saturation point is going to happen on this planet. And it's not just our kids playing video games. I believe that in the future, our websites will be virtual. So there was a time not long ago when an American journalist on a daytime talk show was discussing a new technology. And she was trying to figure out what this technology was. And she puts her finger in her ear and she starts talking to her producer and she said, "Can you tell me what the internet is?" And that's where we are with virtual reality. People are asking, how can we use virtual reality? What is the point of virtual reality? Is it just for gaming? It's not just for gaming. We were all forced as business owners to create a website at one point, whether we liked it or not. Whatever service you were using, that same saturation point is going to happen with the virtual reality. Why not have a storefront or an avatar that can represent you and your business and deal with your customers when you're offline? This is the virtual web 3.0 that we're going to experience. So basically, we're entering a brave new simulated future where everything that we experience in this virtual world feels just as real as the reality we see around us now. I don't think we can quite imagine that unless you've tried on a pair of Oculus Rift headsets and you've seen how real this world has become. The virtual effects singularity, we could call it that as well, we are finally getting to a place where we can mimic the body, we can mimic the face, so that it is so real that you cannot tell a difference. We're not there with the face yet, but with the body, we are. I would say 75% of what you see in your daily life when you're watching television, and especially commercials, none of that's real. But it's become so real that we have fooled ourselves into believing that what we've seen throughout our day is a real location, a real person, a real machine. But 75% of that was created in a virtual world. So the digital mirror effect really is we are projecting into the virtual world who we are as a species. And I think business owners have a huge responsibility to decide what they're going to project into this future. We have a huge responsibility to the future itself. When the people of the future look back at us in this time, because everything is being recorded and digitized, we have a huge responsibility to leave a legacy of equality. And in businesses in general, the best way to do that is to question, what is my business practice? Why am I interested in the digital world? What is the future of this machine that we're building if we're talking about artificial intelligence? So simulated world building that has real world implications. What if we could run simulations to cure cancer? What if we could run simulations that would save astronauts from dying in space? Or run simulations for us to live on Mars or the moon? Well, these simulations are being run right now, and we're figuring out things that we never thought were possible. Cures for cancer. 10 years ago, if you had said we would cure cancer on this planet, you would have been called crazy. And today, we are starting to see these cures. So procedurally generated algorithmic perspective simulations. This is how we get to a true virtual simulated reality. I've had people say to me before, it's impossible to generate enough computing power to simulate a world that's realistic. Absolutely wrong. All you need to generate is what you can see in front of you at any given time. Procedurally generated finite algorithms that allow you to let the computer create the world that you see. That's all that needs to be generated. Everything around your perspective, everything that's going on outside of this room, can be low resolution. It doesn't need to be high resolution. In any given moment, I could have a microscope and look deep into my body and see things that I don't see on a normal basis. I don't need those things to be high resolution unless I'm looking directly at them. So procedurally generated algorithms could create the future of a simulated world that is as real as the one we're in right now. So again, the virtual web. The web 3.0 will be a simulated 3D virtual reality filled with avatar replicas. Now think about that. Avatar replicas that represent us when we're not online. And you could record your interaction with your customers and your friends and your family and have that playback for you in a later date. This idea is important because how many of us have customer interaction at the top of our list when we think about what's important for our business model? You, especially today in a viral social networking world, you really need to focus on your interaction with the customer. And that customer is now very vocal. Each person has their social media. We're living in a review economy. So that interaction, if you could digitize it and have it represent you, that could increase the ability to control those interactions and have a deeper influence on how they view your company and you as an individual. So laser pattern object avoidance. So a lot of people have been asking, so okay, I'm wearing an Oculus Rift headset. My vision is blocked. Yes, I'm seeing a virtual world, but it's not the world that's around me. There's a couple of companies that are developing laser pattern object avoidance systems so that even if you're wearing the Oculus Rift headset, it's scanning the real world and augmenting that world for you. So there's an interaction between what you're seeing inside of the virtual space and what's actually in front of you. So I remember when I first moved to New York, I lived near Bellevue Hospital, and this was around 13 years ago, and I would see people walking around the street talking to themselves. And what I realized was that Bluetooth had become saturated in the market. And I think the same thing is going to happen with the Oculus Rift and with virtual reality headsets. We are going to see people walking around with these on their faces. As crazy as that sounds, this is what's going to happen. So the simulated memory economy, we're also going to see a lot of this, trading virtual memories. We're going to be creating virtual simulations and sharing those with our friends and family. And we've talked a lot about wearables in the future studies groups, but now we're going to see implantables. So there's a direct communication with the internet and your brain. We will see centers for people who become addicted to virtual realities. And the most important thing, and what I want to leave you with today, the millennial idea is over. We are about to enter the sim generation. It's a new generation where they have control over their reality. If they don't want to be in this reality, they will create their own. They will make it very simple to scan and create virtual simulated realities. And I do think the sim generation will have some specific effects on our society. One of them in particular is morphological freedom. If any of you have played Second Life, you know that you can be anything and anyone. So we're going to see morphological freedom become a big influence in the sim generation. So I just want to leave you with this thought that we are crunching our digital information, our digital selves, and we are beginning to simulate a virtual reality. Everything that we put into this simulation, we will take with us into the future. And so I think we have to question, what do we take with us? What's important to us as a species? Thank you.
Third and final speaker for this session is Gert Leonard, the CEO of the Futures Agency. And Gert's chapter in the book explores this challenge that we can all perceive now of this clash between humanity and the machines, and how does it play out? Just because technology can do something, should we let it? What choice should humanity have about how things play out and how we make the technology serve ourselves? And Gert's going to come up and share with us some of the key thoughts from that chapter. Thank you, Gert.
All right, you can all take a deep breath now. Whew. I mean, I'm a futurist, but that future was fast and mind-boggling. I'm going to bring it down to the ground a little bit more. Personally, I think I would rather have 10% of my actual reality than 1,000% of virtuality. But let's discuss that later in the group when we have the breakout sessions later to figure out what would go on. If I can have my slides in the front, it would be good. So first of all, in the last 6 months, I've been thinking a lot about what happens with man and machine, just observing around me. And 2 years ago, I was in Zanzibar with my son, who was 18, my younger son, and that was the first time in his life when he did not have the internet. So sitting on the beach and he wants to play music, he keeps furiously hitting the button, nothing happens, and he says, my mobile is dead. I said, it's not the mobile, you don't have internet. The first time in his life, apart from being, of course, in the womb and later, where I don't think he had internet. But that's when I realized what is happening in exponential developments. And so I've been working on this a lot in the last 6 months, the idea of how technology relates to people. I made a movie called Tech versus Human, and I have a thing called The Future Show that you can imbibe online and take a look at that. So this was mentioned many times before, exponential. And we keep hearing this everywhere. There's a great book called Exponential Organization I recommend, apart from our own book, of course, to also read. Exponential means that we're now in a place to where we're at the takeoff point. You know, when you count 1, 2, 3, that's almost the same than counting 1, 2, 4. But between 4 and 8, there's a big leap. All right, so we're now going to a world that's basically, as my other colleagues have already said, I think humanity will change more in the next 20 years than the previous 300. Now, that is a good thing and a bad thing. And I coined a word for this called hell-ven, which is hell and heaven, right? Depending on how you look at it. I mean, what we're going to see in those times is not a question of the motto of this event, what if? The question is what when? Right? I mean, what if you ask whether technology can actually do something or not, 5 years ago we used to say, well, it's going to be costly, it's going to be expensive, it's going to take a long time. But the reality is, now the question is whether we should do something, not whether we can. And that is a very, very big difference, right? Should we create machines that can emulate humans to the point of general intelligence, not just playing chess, but beyond? Should we do that? Should we change our businesses to be based on questions of assumptions and abundance and all these things? I mean, if we're looking at this clearly, computer performance in roughly 2027, computers will reach the possibility of having the capacity of one human brain. In 2050, Ray Kurzweil says, one computer will have the capacity of all human brains. Right? I'm talking about exponential here. I don't know which brain, but I suppose at this point our brains would be mimicked. And we're looking at this as a scenario, for example, genome sequencing, right? Which used to cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. In 5 years, it will be cheaper than flushing the toilet. So at that point, it becomes ubiquitous to be able to do this. So, I mean, we're looking at a society that's largely changed by this interface between man and machine. And if you ask kids today, you know, in the range of, say, 15 to 30, I would call those kids, right? Who is the best friend? You know what the answer is 30% of the time? Who is their best friend? The mobile phone. What a sad response, right? I mean, of course, I'm not 25, right? But what are we going to say in 5 years? My best friend is the cloud, or my friend the robot? I mean, that is a strange perversion in my view. But looking at this as a business-wise, as a hell-then scenario, it's heaven because you can fire lots of people and use technology to take their part, right? It's efficient, it's good, makes money, increases the margin. But it changes our lives completely. When we have predictive analytics that IBM is suggesting, we can send out the engine, so to speak, to say, well, who in my company is the least productive, according to the engine, right? And then we fire those people first. That's obviously productive, and it's predictive, it's digital, right? And there's a company that our friend Zuckerberg, we know from other nefarious ventures, has invested a couple of $100 million in. This company called Vicarious, it says, we're building software that thinks and learns like a human. How does that sound to you? Right? I mean, basically, you want to say, you must be joking. Right? I mean, that's my point of view, right? Do I really want software to think and learn like a human? I want software to help me think like a human. Right? Software that serves me, not vice versa. Software that thinks like a human is the idea of attaining superintelligence, right? Being omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent. That's not a good idea. It's a good idea to have business superintelligence, obviously. That's very useful. But is that the holy grail of what we're trying to do here, to become superhuman? Like IBM's new chip, the neurosynaptic system. This is not a joke, right? This is a chip to emulate the neurosynaptic system. In production now. So basically what we're seeing here is now a world that's deeply impacted by digitization, automation, virtualization, and robotization. I call them the Asians, and you can add other ones to that. First the media companies, then telecom, utilities, financial services, government. Call centers, any of you guys running call centers? In 5 years, 92% of call centers can be run by software. automated translation, analysis, semantic learning. We talk about a scenario that's probably going to be deeply concerning, and Peter Diamandis calls this the age of abundance. If you read his book, Abundance, which is a good read, but extremely American California ideology, I would say. But in any case, the case of abundance means that technology will make everything very cheap. If you're in the music business, you know what I'm talking about, right? It used to be 20 quid for a CD. Now it's what, 8 quid for 16 million songs on Spotify. And the same thing will happen in other industries. Do you really think that when the car is shared publicly and electric and self-driving, you're going to get 80,000 quid for a nice car? It becomes a commodity. So at that point, we have to change our business models. We have to think about what happens here. This great chart by Kleiner Perkins, Mary Meeker, comes out once a year, famous for her slideshows. She says one really important thing in the 160-page document that she makes every year. Right? That's basically that non-routine cognitive jobs, that's very good language here, fits perfectly, has exploded. If you're looking at the green line, right, that's most of us are doing non-routine cognitive jobs. Right? But see what happens with those jobs. Basically, non-routine cognitive jobs are now, according to research, in 10 to 25 years, financial advisors, for example, that do this kind of work will also be replaced. Automation is moving up from the blue collar to the white collar, and that's us and our kids. And I think it's not all a bad thing because there will be plenty of new things that we can do there, but basically technological unemployment is real. This time, it's real. It has always been considered a threat, even in the industrial age, right? This time, it's real. And it's exponential. Martin Luther King already talked about the basic income guarantee. We may end up there faster than you think. I think this could be very liberating. Imagine you wouldn't have to work for money, but work for something that you really want to do, which is not always the same. I'm lucky in my job it is, right? But how many of us, let's be honest, have in the past worked like robots, right, for the jobs? Those jobs would no longer be required. Right? We're talking about situations like autonomous vehicles where we're seeing quite clearly how quickly that is happening. But do you really think in 10 years you can hop in a car somewhere in Norway and have it drive you to the polar circle by itself? Doubtful. Because it takes tens of thousands of things for that to work. What we're going to see, rather than artificial intelligence here, is what I call intelligent assistance, the reverse. And that's a great business. So if you're in business, you should shoot for that first. Intelligent assistance and augmentation, making your service better using intelligent technologies. And that is roughly a $6 trillion market. And lots of research on this showing the intelligence that we used to want, for example, this is an example of Siri, right? 3 years ago, where you say, I think I have alcohol poisoning, and Siri gives you more liquor stores. Right? Now, that is truly intelligent. But what happens in the future, of course, now this is becoming very, very powerful. The latest demo of Siri 2 weeks ago at the Apple event, absolutely mind-boggling. Look at this growth from the Financial Times, right? Growth in digital assistant systems, it'll be there for media, for banking, for infrastructure, for logistics, for transportation. That's a great and big business, much more tangible than true artificial intelligence. But here's a question I have for you. Would ubiquitous digital assistants make us utterly lazy and useless? Well, chances are, for example, if you could just walk down the street and the assistant would tell you what you should read first, where you should go eat, who you may want to get to know to marry later because the DNA has a match and so on, right? That would basically disable our own functionality. Just like the cab driver can no longer even drive around the corner without the Google Maps. Is that a bad thing or is it inevitable? Here's a quick clip by a company called Jibo that's proposing exactly this.
This is your house. This is your car. This is your toothbrush. These are your things. But these are the things that matter. And somewhere in between is this guy. Introducing Jibo, the world's first family robot. Say hi, Jibo.
Hi, Jibo.
I'll spare you the rest, right? But the clip is proposing, actually, that this machine is not a robot, it's a friend, right? Makes you wonder what else it would do if you're not watching. Right? But anyways, I mean, what is happening here, clearly the future of work will be the question, will we write on top of technology, or will it write on top of us? That is a key question. That's not a marginal question. Right? And that is what we have to decide right now. We have to decide what is okay and what is not okay. Should we be turned into technology because it's a better fit for those providing technology, because it makes trillions of dollars? The singularity feedback loop, so-called, suggests that once you implement enough technology, it can implement and improve itself, called recursive improvement. That would be worse than any kind of nuclear incident. Because, right? We're talking about technology that essentially amplifies itself. What about the social contract? Will a machine or a software know anything about our social contracts, those marginal things called love, emotions, mistakes, lies, accidents, serendipity? Should we erase all of this because it's a better fit with a machine? We do need a contract for artificial intelligence, a social contract based on this, right? Because we do have a nuclear non-proliferation agreement called the NPT, right, to help with that, but we don't have that here. So that's a very big discussion that I think we should have. As my good friend Sophocles said a couple of years ago, nothing vast enters the life of mortals without a curse. I kept out the out. It's a Freudian spelling here, right? Without a curse, of course. Sorry about that. But here's a key question, right? Will these technologies be nuclear weapons or nuclear energy? I mean, you could argue if nuclear energy is positive, I would say maybe sometimes it is, right? But technology is 98% the same. How do we actually do this in the future? How do we put this together? So let me ask you a question. What do you believe in? Do you believe in this? Technology is a fix for everything. Then you should move to California. Just kidding. No. Technology is not the fix for it. It is obviously a great fix for a lot of things. It can make green energy work. It can make our businesses efficient. It can create new economies. It can make lots of money. But in the end, human existence is a lot more than this, right? It's a lot more than my brain on an electronic array. A lot, lot more. And I don't think I want that to change. Descartes said that essentially an animal is a machine, called the machina, and he drew a duck to demonstrate the duck could be copied, and a bunch of people made an artificial duck as a consequence. This is called the Vaupasson duck, right? And this thing is called reductionism, reducing reality to something that you can copy, right? You do not want to be close to reductionism. On the left, you have a nice picture of the beach on your computer, and that's roughly about, say, 5% of reality. When you're actually on the beach, this is Goa, I was there last week, 100% reality. Right? There's a vast difference here. We shouldn't confuse the two just because they're similar. Right? It's woefully inadequate. So those two things, automation and intelligence, are our future the next 5 years. Lots of new companies, lots of companies around the world are looking to automate to save costs and to become intelligent, to be better. And that's a good thing. But let's not forget this one point here, right? This tiny one point. Consciousness, embodiment, awareness, sentience, purpose. I'm not talking about religion here, I'm talking about values, right? Really simple stuff. Right? What's going to happen with that? Right? What is the future of that? So what do we do with this? I have a couple of tips and then I'll wrap up. Technology does not have ethics. It can't. It's a machine, right? Would you trust a machine to have a social contract? Every business that we have has to have ethics. There's no business without ethics. There would be no point in it. So embrace, but transcend technology. That's the key message here. Purpose, relevance, relationships, brand, and trust. Everything that can be automated will be automated. And everything that cannot be automated will explode in value. The value of our companies is not just in automation, right? But We don't just want to make things efficient. Beware of this idea of using technology to automate everything, because it's basically called machine thinking. The concept of saying that you can use technology to bypass all the burdensome humans, the wetware that we don't want, the unintended consequences. Amazon drones in the US has already proven in the areas where people are thinking about having drones, people are buying guns. Right? Makes perfect sense. That's certainly an unintended consequence, but we have to think about that, right? We need to install one thing when it's about technology in the future of what we do. One really important thing, and that is called the precautionary principle. If you're going to invent something very large and powerful, you should be sure that no unintended consequences will have catastrophic results. And this is crucial, I think, when we're talking about stuff of the future. Isaac Asimov said he doesn't care about being a speed reader or a super brain, and we shouldn't care about that either. He says he's a speed understander. Our role is not to be faster than machines. Our role is to focus on understanding, synthesis, empathy, stories, experience, the right brain. That's our future in business. We're going to see a lot of these things happening, making substantial shifts like Uber has done. This whole idea of disruption. Don't celebrate disruption. That's just the first step. Celebrate construction. And you can disrupt first, but then you also have to put it back together. It's not enough for Uber to disrupt taxis, right, like they want to do in New York, replace all the taxis with 9,000 Ubers. Right? Great idea, but what about the social infrastructure around this? What about the public service? Right? What about the things that are not technology? What about the things that you have to do? Don't stop with disruption. Construct new ecosystems. That's the mission. That's, of course, the business of the future. And Apple, for example, is showing the way here, I think. Apple is putting people back into music. Right? The new launch of Apple Music is not about better algorithms. It's about DJs, right? Old-fashioned DJs. The same goes for Apple News. They are hiring journalists, for crying out loud, right? They're not hiring data scientists. Well, they also have plenty of those. Right? It's about the synthesis of those two things, right? People and technology. Not just technology, probably not just people. So that's kind of our future, right? We have one cloud over here with the tech things, and the other cloud over here, which is entirely human. And our choice really is only to synthesize those two things. That's the future of business, in my view, and it's something that we have to work on pretty hard. Balance, man and machine. And the other day somebody complained, so I put in woman and machine. Right? So balance those two things. Right? And I will skip ahead because I'm pretty much out of time. My most important point is stick with the human imperative. Embrace technology, but stick with the fact that it has to be good for humans, even if it looks more complicated. Thanks very much for your attention.